We'll start off the afternoon with Karen Veltman. She's an assistant research scientist at the University of Michigan Ann Arbor. She got a PhD in environmental science in the Netherlands. I'd love to share with you the city, but I can't say that. How do you say it?
In Nijmegen.
All right. And then I had a postdoc in environmental impact assessment in Norway. And she now, focuses on quantifying nutrient flows and environmental impacts associated with livestock production, including dairy, so just a subset, and identifying opportunities for improvement. So take it away, Karen. Thanks.
Good morning, everyone. I'm going to talk today about a quantitative assessment of beneficial management practices to reduce the carbon, reactant nitrogen, and phosphorus footprints of dairy farms in the Great Lakes region. I would like to say that this work has really been a team effort, so I would first like to acknowledge all my co-authors for their contributions. I also have to say that this work is based on a grant from the USDA and that any opinions, findings, conclusions, or recommendations expressed in this presentation are my own and don't necessarily reflect the view of the USDA. So dairy products are nutrient-rich products that provide essential nutrients such as calcium, vitamin D, and potassium. They are included in dietary guidelines worldwide. However, dairy production is also associated with some environmental challenges that manifest themselves at local, regional, and global scales. And these include climate change, air pollution, eutrophication, and resource extraction. So climate change, dairy production emits greenhouse gases. In the U.S., approximately 1.9% of the total U.S. greenhouse gas emissions is associated with dairy, with the dairy production sector. And enteric methane is the main or the dominant source on the farm of the greenhouse gas emissions. Dairy production is also associated with relatively large emissions of ammonia. Approximately 18% of the U.S. total emissions comes from dairy. And the main sources are manure storage and land application of both manure and fertilizer. Further, there is some leaching of nitrogen and phosphorus, also runoff and erosion that causes eutrophication, both in coastal areas and in lakes. And then only for P, we have some impacts on natural resources because P is mined from, or P fertilizer is created from phosphate rock, which is a limited resource. So if we want to improve the sustainability, the environmental sustainability of dairy production, we would like to reduce emissions of the greenhouse gases, of our ammonia, and of NMP leaching, runoff, and erosion. Several beneficial management practices have been shown to reduce these environmental footprints. However, most of these beneficial management practices have been tested in isolation. So either they look at one specific pollutant, either looking at greenhouse gases or nitrogen emissions. And usually they focus on only one source of the farm, so either looking at the animal or the manure storage or the field. However, on the farm, of course, our NP and C flows are interrelated. And often what is the case is if you reduce one specific pollutant, it may increase your losses of another pollutant, which is called pollutant swapping. And of course, if we want to reduce environmental impacts, we want to prevent this from happening. So we need a whole farm approach, looking at all the different environmental footprints and also looking at all the different emissions of greenhouse gases and nitrogen and phosphorus losses. What is furthermore important is that for the farmer, of course, beneficial management practices should not only reduce your footprint, your environmental footprint on the farm, but for the farmer it's also important that he can maintain his productivity, both in terms of milk and crop yield, and that the farm remains profitable. So we do not want to implement venomous fishery management practices that actually sacrifice farm productivity and profitability. So the aim of our project is to evaluate the efficacy of individual beneficial management practices on reducing carbon, reactive nitrogen and phosphorus footprints of two representative dairy farms in the Great Lakes region, and to identify and assess an integrated set of BMPs that can be applied to reduce those footprints of the whole farm without sacrificing productivity or profit to the farmer. So what we did is that we first developed or defined two baseline farms, and I have to say that these are model farms, they are not real commercial farms, but these farms are thought to be representative for current dairy farming practices in the Great Lakes region. So we identified a large farm with 1,500 cows and a small farm with 150 cows. We took two farm sizes as farm sizes known to affect environmental impacts. The large farm was placed in New York State and the small farm in Wisconsin. And then we identified the BMPs that we want to simulate. For the feed, we identified six BMPs that we wanted to simulate in the model. Our baseline model had some corn silage, alfalfa silage ratio of 1:1. High corn silage to alfalfa of a ratio from 3:1 is a trend in the US. It's made necessarily via BMP, but there's a movement in the US towards this ratio. The baseline also had 65% forage intake. The BMP is to reduce this forage intake to 50%, and this is expected to have an effect on greenhouse gas emissions, particularly on enteric methane emissions. BMP has a low NDF digestibility, baseline, and then our BMP will have a higher digestibility of these fibers, increased to 2%. And this is predicted to have an effect on both on milk production, which is predicted to increase, and it may also, well, this is not a good effect, it might also increase our methane emissions from storage. And what I should have said before, with our feed BMPs, they can actually have two different effects. Either the feed BMPs, they reduce absolute emissions of the greenhouse gases, or they increase milk production. So we see a relative reduction in our emissions. Next BMP, a high feed efficiency, has an impact on milk production. Milk production increases and thus the greenhouse gas emissions decrease, the relative emissions per kilogram milk produced. High fat can suppress enteric methane emissions and might also increase milk production. And then the final one is a reduced protein content, which decreases the urea M in urine, and that will reduce emissions of ammonia from manure storage and maybe on land application. The second list of BMPs are for the manure storage. Here we have BMPs that are specific for the farm type. So we have three BMPs for the small farm and four BMPs for the large farm. And the first BMP for the small farm in the baseline, we had a bedded back barn that was changed with a freeze stall, which can have effects of nitrous oxide emissions on the barn floor. The second one was to replace the bottom-loaded tank with a storage with a cover. This can also reduce your nitrous oxide emissions. And then the third is to also have a covered storage, but then also to equip it with a flare so that you can burn your methane. For the large farm, we also used this sealed with flare, and then we had three other BMPs: separation, anaerobic digestion, and separation and digestion. Separation is thought to reduce methane emissions and ammonia volatilization, both from the storage and the land application. Anaerobic digestion reduces methane from the manure storage, but as has been mentioned before, the reduction potential really depends on how efficient your anaerobic digester is and how well it is maintained. It may, however, increase ammonia volatilization from the manure storage. And then separation and digestion is thought to reduce methane emissions from manure storage, although maybe nitrous oxide emissions may go up. So then the last list of BMPs are for the field. We have 6 BMPs for the field, starting with the cover crop. So it will have effects on erosion losses and leaching. Summer application, I should have said that this has mainly effects on the nitrogen emissions. Rye double crop also can affect erosion losses from both P and N. Incorporating the manure on the same day, in contrast to broadcast application, reduces ammonia volatilization. However, it may have a negative effect on nitrous oxide emissions from the field. No-till, in comparison to a conventional till, reduces erosion P and N losses. And then the last one is a no-till with subsurface injection. And that can reduce erosion losses and leaching and also ammonia volatilization. So after having identified all these BMPs and the baselines, the next step was to simulate the baselines as well as the BMPs in the model. And for this we used the integrated farm system model. The integrated farm system model is a process-based model. It models the whole farm, including many different components of the farm. It has the field, it has the manure storage, it has animals, manure handling. And it models all the nutrient and carbon flows between these different farm components based on processes, based on known processes. The IFSM model can predict carbon reactive nitrogen footprints, and it predicts leaching erosion and runoff losses for P, so we can also calculate the footprint, the P footprint. We express this per kilogram milk produced as a manner of comparison, and one of the unique characteristics of the IFSM model in comparison to other whole farm models is that it can also give you an idea
of
the...
I'm not sure what you said. Sorry.
So unique characteristic of IFSM is that it can also give you an idea of the economic performance of your farm as it predicts net return given in dollar per cow. We also did some comparison with other process-based models, but I will not show those results here, just focusing on the results from IFSM. So these are first the results on the milk production, because of course if we increase milk production, we decrease our relative emissions. So this is the baseline milk production for the New York farm, the large farm, and the Wisconsin farm, which is a small farm. These milk productions are thought to be representative of the different states. So, and more generally, the large farm would have higher milk production than a small farm, but because these are representative of the different states, this is different here. The different feed BMPs, they can influence milk production. And as we can see here, there are 3 feed BMPs that increase milk production in 2.5, 7.5, and 4.9%. And if we combine several of the BMPs into a whole feed mitigation strategy, we can have an approximate increase in our milk production of 10%. So what you can see here is that these things are also, or the BMPs are only partly additive. Then showing the results for the carbon footprint. So this is a carbon footprint of the whole farm, and it also includes emissions associated with purchases and machinery, which is in orange. So the carbon footprint is expressed in kilogram CO2 equivalents per kilogram milk produced. First looking at the baseline, this has a carbon footprint of approximately 1 kilogram CO2 equivalent per kilogram milk produced. And you can see that the dominant contributors to this footprint are enteric methane, as well as the footprint associated with purchases and machinery. Then looking at the feed BMPs and their impact on the carbon footprint, there are three feed BMPs that actually decrease the carbon footprint of 9, 7, and 4%, and this is the high, the 50% forage, the high feed efficiency, and reduced protein. The first two mainly affected because they increase milk production, and the reduced protein impacts our carbon footprint because it reduces nitrous oxide emissions. And then looking at the manure. Oh, sorry, I first have to say that the combined feed mitigation strategy can reduce the carbon footprint with 21% for the whole farm. Manure, all the four BMPs actually reduce the carbon footprint between 15 and 20%. There are some differences between the different strategies. You can see that actually the sealed with flare is the most efficient one, and that is because it can fully, or it reduces the manure N2O emissions completely, and it also completely reduces the methane emissions. And there's still some methane emission associated with anaerobic digestion because of leakage from the digester. Feed BMPs, field BMPs, they don't really reduce the whole farm impact. There is only a reduction of less than 0.1%. So the next thing that we did then was to combine these different BMPs into a whole farm mitigation strategy and see how far we can reduce our footprint for the farm. So the first strategy takes these different BMPs, and that, we called it strategy three, that reduces our carbon footprint with 34%, and then taking also the cover crop and the sugar application into it, it's a slightly higher, but only slightly higher reduction of 35%. So the next environmental impact results are the reactive nitrogen footprints. So I have to go a bit quicker. Reactive nitrogen footprints. Reactive nitrogen is all nitrogen except of D-nitrogen, also expressed in kilogram milk produced. Baseline, and you can see ammonia as a dominant contributor. And then looking at the field, the feed BMPs, there are two that actually reduce our footprint with 10 and 14%. Of course, the reduced protein is one of them. And the high feed efficiency, as I said before, it increases milk production and thus decreases your relative footprint. The total feed mitigation strategy can reduce with 25%. And then, our manure BMPs actually did not have so much effect on the reactive nitrogen footprint, only reduction from 3 to 5% with separation and digestion. And then for the field, we see reductions between 4 and 12%. There was one BMP that actually increased the footprint. And then if we combine this again into a whole farm strategy, we can see a reduction of 36 and 41%. So then I quickly want to show you the pea footprint. The pea footprint, of course, feed will not have such a big influence on your pea footprint. It actually increases the pea footprint a bit. There is only one that manages to decrease the pea footprint because milk production is increased. The manure also did not really affect our pea footprint, but of course the field actually does reduce the pea footprint because it can reduce our erosion losses. So here we can get a 45% reduction in the whole farm footprint, basically by introducing cover crops and by applying no-till and no-till with injection. The whole farm strategy, the first one, if you remember correctly, this one did not include this BMP of cover crops, so we actually, here we don't see any advantage. This one did include the cover crop, so we can reduce our pea footprint with 52%. And these are the results for the whole farm. This shows the percent change with respect to the baseline, and anything positive is good. So it shows that we can reduce our reactive nitrogen and our carbon footprint with around 35%. Also maintaining the milk production and increasing the net return, so increasing the profitability of the farm. This did not have such a good effect on our pea, but then the maximum mitigation, we can also manage to reduce our pea footprint for the whole farm. I will not show the details of the small farm, but it's actually the same story. We can avoid all our three environmental impacts with increasing the net return and increasing milk production. So to conclude, an integrated set of BMPs can reduce the carbon footprint with 35%, simultaneously reducing reactive nitrogen and phosphorus footprints with 40% and 40-50%, as well as increasing farm productivity and long-term profits. We see the same results for the small and the large farms. And what we found, what we think, is that whole farm process-based models are useful tools for a holistic assessment of BMPs in a whole farm context, and they can include an environmental and economic assessment of our BMPs for a whole farm. Thank you for your attention.